You're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator George Maziarz. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the senator and I are going to talk about what's going on in the New York State Senate. How are you?
Good, Julia. How are you doing?
Good.
Summer is finally here, I think.
Yes. And Mother's Day was yesterday.
Mother's Day was yesterday.
And I know you have an annual event in
Lockport. Yes. 15 right? years now. We've been, my wife and my daughters have been participating, along with myself, in the Mother's Day Breast Cancer Awareness Canal Walk. It's right on the banks of the Erie Canal. Every year, hundreds and hundreds of people get together and raise money for Mary's Room, the American Cancer Society. It's a great fundraiser. It's a great day. I know in the past 15 years, we've had some days that have had very good weather and other days that have been, you know, some questionable weather. But I think yesterday was a record turnout. It was a beautiful day. And I don't know how much was raised, but I'm sure it was a considerable amount of money. And just, it's all volunteer work, and it's really a good thing. And I challenged everyone there that next year to bring a friend along with them. We're going to double the attendance and hopefully double the amount of money we raise.
A nice way to celebrate women.
It is. It is.
You have created a strategy that would really bridge the gap between state government and Native Americans. You announced at a news conference last week that you'll be heading a committee on Native American relations.
Yes. Senator Skelos, the Senate Majority Leader, has authorized a committee, a Senate Select Committee. And as you know, a Select Committee actually will be formed by resolution of the full Senate. It will contain members from both sides of the aisle. And we will hold hearings. We're charged with holding hearings, establishing a relationship with the various Native American nations. And one of the things, of course, I'm from the western end of the state, and I deal primarily with the Senecas and the Tuscaroras. But, you know, obviously we have the Oneidas in central New York and the St. Regis, the Mohawks, excuse me, up in the northern part of the state, but various Native American nations all across the state. With different issues, you know, based upon culture, history, geography, whatever. And what we hope to do is at least bridge the gap from a communication standpoint to help. One of the things that I noticed almost immediately, you know, from having grown up in Western New York, having grown up, you know, having some very good friends that are, you know, members of both the Tuscarora and Seneca Nation, that a lot of my colleagues, particularly those from the downstate region, really don't understand the Native American culture, really don't understand, some of the issues that the Native Americans have. And hopefully this committee, which is going to explore a lot of different issues, will help bridge that communications gap. And one of the things that I'm most excited about, and I think that President Porter, the Seneca Nation, mentioned, was about the Seneca Nations being so interested in economic development, in creating jobs. You know, I mentioned at the press conference that, you know, the Seneca Nation has employed in Niagara County almost 4,000 people. And you know, they're good-paying jobs. They're jobs that have health insurance. You know, and that is a, you know, there's chronically high unemployment in Western New York. I can't imagine what it would be if, you know, they are one of the largest employers in Western New York. And I think we can replicate that, excuse me, in other areas of the state.
Yeah, you brought up that the different Indian nations have separate unique needs. The president of the Seneca Nation that you were just talking about, President Porter, talked about this at the news conference, and he talked about why it's so important to have a system in place to make sure that everyone is communicating better.
Yes, exactly. And that's what this committee is really all about. I suspect the direction that we're going to go in is holding hearings, start off with hearings, and really have individuals. I indicated to Senator Skelos and in my discussions with the Native American leaders, look, there are going to be people on this committee who vehemently disagree with some of the positions that the Native Americans have taken, and we're going to hold hearings and listen to all sides and try to, at least I think, to establish an open dialogue. And that's something that's been missing for an awful long time.
Right. Let's right now go to a clip of President Porter talking about how he needs to educate the legislature.
Okay.
Each one of our nations is a separate sovereign nation. and we have a unique history, and we also have a unique history with the state. At the same time, it makes sense that the state might want to standardize its approach to dealing with certain issues. But the point being is that over time, the legislature has not been a participant in this process at all, and it has been largely subject to the sort of ebb and flow of the executive. And that has resulted in a great degree of irregularity, of inconsistency, of real dysfunction as you look over the decades. So one of the things that we would hope to work with the committee on is to educate and to inform so that the legislative body understands the differences that exist within our nations. We have different forms of government. We have different approaches and different philosophies. And I think that that is the foundation of having good relations in the future. And whether contracts or compacts or agreements emerge, that will be a completely separate thing.
So 15 other states have something like this
Yes.
in place, right?
Yes, they do. And ironically enough, New York, with all of the various Native American nations, we've never had a Senate Select Committee dealing with Native American affairs. And I think that what President Porter said was so accurate and so right on, that the Native American nations have been so used to dealing with the executive branch. And sometimes, in the last, 15 years, we've had four governors. And sometimes the messages are very mixed that you get from the executive branch. And the legislature has almost been totally left out of the process at all. You know, many times in budget bills, issues dealing with Native American nations are sent in. And again, the legislature, not having a very clear understanding, would just pass them. And, you know, hopefully this is going to open a dialogue.
Right. I'd like to now show the viewers a clip of you talking about how much the Native Americans contribute to
Sure.
Western New York.
Great. In Western New York, the Seneca Nation, for example, pumps over $1 billion into the local economy. I can tell you firsthand that in the city of Niagara Falls and Niagara County, the Seneca Nation of Indians employs almost 4,000 non-Native Americans in good-paying jobs that have health insurance coverage, which today we all know is so important.
So what's the next step?
Now, I made that point about health insurance coverage because today health insurance is so important to people. You think of the impact of that on our local hospitals in Western New York. I mean, hospitals you will always read about and hear when they say that people come into the emergency room that don't have any kind of insurance at all or on Medicaid, it ends up costing the taxpayers. Here are 4,000 people with health insurance that, are, in a way, saving the taxpayers an awful lot of money.
Right. So what is the next step with this?
Well, the next step is I think we're going to start working with my staff. First of all, Senator Skelos and Senator Sampson have to appoint the members of the committee. Senator Skelos has designated me the chairman of the committee, but he has to, and I've been in consultation with him, talking about the majority members, the Republican members that are going to be on the committee. Senator Sampson has not indicated as of yet exactly what members are going to be on. Now, at the press conference, Senator Adams was there from New York City. Senator Kennedy was there from Western New York. Those are the Democratic members that were there. So I don't know if that's indicative of the fact Senator Sampson is going to appoint them or not. That's clearly up to him. So we get the members of the committee appointed. We get the committee formed. Right after the session is over with, I want to start with the hearing process. And this summer, I suspect we're going to be going around the state holding hearings with the various Native American leaders. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if we didn't start off in Western New York.
Right.
Only because the chairman designates the time and place of the meeting. So you can bet we'll start in Western New York.
Makes sense. It makes sense to start there anyway,
it
really.
Does.
I understand that you and a local assemblyman met with the governor's appointment secretary about
Yes.
the New York Power.
We met with Judge Leslie Leach, the governor's appointment secretary, and talked to him about the importance of a Niagara County representative as a member of the Board of Trustees of the New York Power Authority. It's something that has been talked about for a long time. You know, the Power Authority operates, it's 17 different generating stations around the state, but they really, really make the bulk of their revenues at Niagara and St. Lawrence. and St. Lawrence has, for a long time, has had a representative on the Board of Trustees. Niagara County, ironically enough, Niagara County probably accounts for, you always hear a different percentage figure, but it's probably in the 80 to 85% range of the revenues of the New York State Power Authority, the Niagara Power Project. And Niagara County has not had a member of the Board of Trustees for many years now. I know former Senator, my predecessor, actually Senator John Daly, was a member of the Board of the Power Authority, but for a very brief period of time. And he was clearly in a holdover kind of status, or in a temporary status. So Assemblyman John Cerreto and I met with Judge Leach and basically gave him a pitch about appointing a member from Niagara County to the board, not just somebody from Western New York, but somebody from Niagara County. It is so important, you know, to have that huge power generating station there at Niagara. And I can tell you, and I think it's accurate, that the feeling is that the people of Western New York don't have a voice on the Power Authority Board of Trustees. So hopefully this governor is going to correct that.
There has been some incidences of texting while driving,
yes.
Accidents, some very serious, some could be really serious. The Senate passed some legislation that would strengthen the texting while
yes.
driving law?
Yeah, you know, we did pass a ban on texting while driving. It was for lack of a better term, a watered-down version. It was a secondary offense. In other words, you had to be stopped for something else, and then if the police officer, law enforcement officer, noticed that you were texting or on your phone or something, then they could give you a ticket for that. This makes it a primary offense. In other words, they can stop you if they have any indication at all that you were texting or talking on your phone or whatever. You know, distracted driving is a cause of a lot of accidents today, you know, particularly when it comes to younger people, not exclusively to young people, but, you know, I don't think I will ever forget in the Rochester area, not in the Rochester area of my district, but in Senator Lisi's district, I think now it was almost 3 years ago, it's five beautiful young girls just graduated from high school, all going to college, all had a great future ahead of them, and they were in an automobile accident that is clearly was because of the driver texting while driving. That was before it was a violation. And it's just a tragedy that has been repeated over and over and over again. Distracted driving is particularly today with all the technology that you have, with hands-free devices and, you know, telephoning, and for some reason or other, you know, most young people, my daughters, you know, they don't like to talk on the phone anymore. Now everything is about texting.
Yeah, right.
So just hopefully people will get the message that it's just not the right thing to do while you're driving.
Right.
And
to have a phone in the hands of an inexperienced driver could be so deadly, let alone
anyone.
It's
a disaster, yeah.
Really.
It's a disaster waiting to happen. It's a disaster that has happened, unfortunately.
Yeah. Last week there was good news about the Purple Heart stamp becoming
yes.
a forever stamp.
Senator Bill Larkin, can't talk enough about Colonel Larkin and his efforts over an 11-year period to get a Purple Heart stamp, and now for it to be made a forever stamp, which means that it'll be available forever, and you know, you can use it regardless of what the postage rates are. Colonel Larkin, a retired Army colonel, represents West Point area. He's just a proud veteran, a proud American, and this was a great effort on his part. It's a great tribute to him too that they did it.
Yeah,
and
really.
You know, it's sad that it took 11 years to do it, but it's over with. So
right. Yeah,
it's a great thing.
Yeah, thanks so much for being
Thank
with
you,
us,
Julie.
Senator.
All right.
For any additional information, you could log on to the Senator's website, maziarz.nysenate.gov.